Welcome to the 74th episode of The Jewish Drinking Show. I'm your host, Rabbi Drew Kaplan. I'm very excited to welcome first-time guest, Mendy Mark, to the show.
Thank you. I'm so happy to be here.
Absolutely. My pleasure. All right. So for those less familiar with Mendy, well, first of all, I go back two decades with Mendy, I think, to the early 2000s, and then we've seen each other here, there, and with mutual friends. And what brings Mendy to the show is not just because I have known him for a couple of decades and because we both enjoy beer, but also because he is the manager at Filler Up Kosher Wines in Teaneck, New Jersey. As the manager at Filler Up Kosher Wines in Teaneck, New Jersey, I got very interested in what has been going on. First of all, just sort of in a general sense, like what happens with the kosher crowd in New Jersey, whether it's holidays in general, whether it's obviously Purim and Passover, what happens with those? Are there certain trends? Are there certain other times of year or holidays or even just Shabbat stuff that goes on? But then very interestingly, we've also had something going on in the world for over a year now of a global pandemic. And I know anecdotally, I've heard about consumption of alcohol in the broader American culture going up. I'm very curious to hear about what's been going on that at least that you've noticed that on the retail level, what's been going on koshering to cater consumers, what's been going on over there in Teaneck. But before we get anywhere further, what are you drinking this evening?
This is actually special dram. And this is has become probably one of my favorites. And it was a limited edition from
for the people listening on podcast. Can you read it out to them?
Yeah. So it's from Berkshire Mountain Distillers in Sheffield, Massachusetts, outside Boston. Mm-hmm. And this is called Shay's Rebellion. It's an American whiskey. Now, also, Drew, I want you to see the back of that. Can you see that symbol?
Something with
there?
Sam Adams.
Yeah. So basically, this whiskey was triple distilled from Sam Adams Cinderbach beer. Do you remember the Cinderbach beer? That was around in the early, I would say, like, mid-aughts.
Really?
And okay. That was when they were putting out bombers, and like they were had 22-ounce bombers, and they had a bunch of, they had like four or five different options.
So that was before I got serious about beer.
Oh, okay. Well, there
I
you go.
I didn't really get serious about beer until like 2012-ish.
Got it. All right. So I was into it like in the, really at that point in time. This was one of the beers that really made me fall in love with beer. And I was so excited that this whiskey has been on the shelf at the store longer than I've been there. And I didn't pick it up and look at the back until probably I was there for about a year when I like, you know, there's a lot of stuff in the store. So it's triple distilled from the Cinderbach beer, which is a fiery Rausch beer / Bock combination. Ooh. And it spent years, as a matter of fact, 42 months in Utopia's cask.
Oh,
right. Wow.
So first of all, you had me at Rausch beer because I'm a sucker for Rausch beers.
But obviously, it's not smoky. The smoke has really come down, come down because of spending all that time in the Utopias.
That'll calm any beer down in Utopias.
Have you ever had Utopias?
So first of all, I had a friend back in Southern California who let me taste a couple of his. But then one of the weirdest things happened in December 2019. So Cincinnati is the home of one of the few production facilities for Sam Adams, and they were celebrating a year anniversary of their tap room. So for local beer bloggers, of which I was a local beer blogger, and they totally randomly reached out to me. They said, hey, do you want some Utopias to celebrate? I'm like, okay, I thought it'd be like a small, like Utopias is a $200 bottle. I'm like, oh, they'll send me like a 50, like some small 100 milliliter maybe. No, they sent me a real full a proper thing. I don't know what to do with the empty can. So if anybody wants to buy that off of me, I'm happy to sell it.
It's a cool bottle.
Wicked cool bottle. So no here problem. Is my 2019 Utopias bottle. So for the podcast people, it's a really cool, it's so very different. For the people actually watching this on video, it's something very different. If anybody wants to buy it off of me, I've got it here. For anybody who's never had Utopias, it's a 28-29% alcohol beer. It's not normal, but it's special.
It drinks almost more like a dram, you know, of you're pouring some, you know, brown liquid than a beer, right?
Yeah. In beers, the closest thing I've had to it is something like a Black Tuesday out of the brewery, which is clocks in, I think, in the maybe 18, 19% alcohol, maybe 20%. So some of those bring the heat, but this, the Utopias was a little bit more winey at sort of like cool, tempered things down. But I'm not drinking Utopias tonight. I'm drinking a double IPA. So cheers.
Nice. L'chaim.
Hey, I hope you've been enjoying the episode so far. I wanted to break in and give you a sneak peek. It's next week's episode featuring Rabbi Reuven Chaim Klein.
I think that it's definitely true that one dimension of this midrash is that it's sort of a social critique against, you know, the recreational use of wine that's devoid of any religious or sort of higher purpose. If it's
really?
just doing it for the fun of it.
Do you think that's a possible aspect of this midrash as a critique of that?
I do think so, because I think that the rabbis looked at the Roman carnivals and they saw what happens at the Roman carnivals where you know the pagans would get drunk and do all kinds of, you know, things that are reminiscent of this midrash, and you know they're trying to teach in an exhortative way, you know, try to limit it and try to stay away from that.
Hope you enjoyed that sneak peek and to next week's episode featuring Rabbi Reuven Chaim Klein, and now back into this week's episode featuring Mendy Mark.
Before we get into what's gone on with the pandemic and what you've seen with people's purchasing predilections during the pandemic, if you will.
Sure.
So what in a pre-COVID, and you've been there for how long?
3 years. I just April 8th was my three. I started Yisru Chag the day after Passover 3 years ago.
All right, so you already had a sense pre-pandemic what's sort of normal-ish.
Totally.
So in a normal year, what do you see as far as, imagine people buy more leading up to Purim and Passover, probably other holidays, maybe Rosh Hashanah, right? People buy more stuff.
Yeah, so this is, again, specific to my store, but in general of, I would say, the kosher stores in the New York, New Jersey area, which I know a lot about, obviously not just because of my store, but I'm in touch with a lot of different managers and owners all over the area. Mm-hmm. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday are usually slow days or days where everyone does their orders and, you know, get everything in. And then Wednesday a little bit, people are starting a little bit. We'll start buying for Shabbos. But again, Thursday and Friday are always the busiest days of the week because we have Shabbos. And so because we have Shabbos, and Shabbos has become not only do, you know, you're making Kiddush, right? But people have also, the Orthodox Jewish world, and this is happening every year more and more, people are drinking more. And again,
is the clientele, the customer base primarily Orthodox of one sort or another?
Okay, so my clientele at the store is primarily Orthodox, but again, it's because I'm in Bergen County, New Jersey. It's primarily Jewish. It's probably like, I don't know, 80% Orthodox. You know what I mean? If you want to say, but I get a lot. You know, there's a very strong conservative and reform communities in Bergen County. There's a few of them. And and so we definitely get a lot of them as well, especially when it comes to simchas. Because when they're doing simchas, then they're usually using an Orthodox kosher caterer, which they need to follow to make sure all the rules when it comes to what alcohol they can have and can have.
So would you be able to break down the Orthodox population, or it really is just a mix?
No, it is definitely a mix, but again, for filler off, I can break it down. We're probably about
You do, is that fairly representative? Your breakdown, is it fairly representative of the area demographically?
Yeah, I mean, I would say like this: Teaneck, New Jersey, is a modern Orthodox, very big modern Orthodox community.
Okay.
We're very close, you know, about 20 minutes or so to Passaic, New Jersey, which is very much a more yeshivish community. Ultra Orthodox, I don't know what words is better that people all know, but like, you know, we probably get about, I would say 10% of our customer, maybe even 15% of our customer base is Passaic. Most of the rest of our Orthodox customers are from Teaneck, Englewood, Fairlawn, you know, all these little towns in Bergen County, all within a 15-minute drive of Teaneck. And again, it's almost, I would say, almost exclusively modern Orthodox, except what we probably have another, I don't know, maybe it's 5 to 10% of our business is people that are from Muncie or Brooklyn, or, you know, not really five towns, although we get a few people because they're coming into Teaneck to go out to dinner. And in New Jersey, it's a very interesting law, is that it's very, most towns in New Jersey do not issue new liquor licenses. And so there in Teaneck, where there's, I don't know, almost 40 kosher restaurants, there's only two that have a liquor license. And all of the others, the law in New Jersey is that if you don't have a liquor license, you are BYOB for wine and beer.
So you can walk into a cafe, can bring it in.
You can go into a cafe or to a pizza place, and you, any restaurant, kosher or not kosher, doesn't matter. If there's no liquor license, it's BYOB for wine and beer. So because of that,
wow,
we get a lot of people that come in at night that are going to, you know, there's a fine dining restaurant a block from us called ETC Steakhouse, that's BYOB, that people that go there and they're like, oh, we want wine. They're like, well, we can't sell you any wine, but there's a liquor store a block away. And so we get, I mean, even tonight, we probably had at least 6 or 7 customers that were going there. I mean, also on the other restaurants on the block that they're coming, you know, whether whatever it may be, for wine or beer. So then we're getting people from all over the place because they're coming, you know, to eat. And so then you get some people that are the more right wing, ultra Orthodox. But most of our customer base is modern Orthodox.
Interesting. So how, what do people like to buy? Sort of really broadly, how popular is wine versus, imagine Jews love their wine. How familiar are they with scotch versus bourbon, other spirits, liqueurs, and then, of course, beers? Like, how much?
Right. In general, right, the modern Orthodox community is, I would say, pretty knowledgeable when it comes to liquor.
Really? And, yeah. Okay, good for them. Good for us.
Yeah.
good for the modern Orthodox.
Right. Now, again, you definitely get a lot of people that are not educated and people that come in and whether they're buying a gift for someone or, you know what I mean, or people that are just getting into it or people that, you know, but again, the best, this is what I realize is people come and they say to me, I want to buy a nice bottle. So a nice bottle for one person could be a $15 bottle and for another person could be a $150 bottle. Mm-hmm. So it's like, you know, to try to figure out, you know what I mean, and try to make it work. And you don't want to embarrass anyone either. You want to be able to, you know what I mean? But I would say going back to the question is that, with wine, so there's, definitely pretty knowledgeable, but again, there's with wine, there's so, thank God, there's so much kosher wine. I watched your podcast with Gabriel Geller. Yeah. And I believe the number he said is that in last year, there was over 4,000 different kosher wines produced. I don't know if that was on your podcast, but I definitely saw it somewhere.
It's very possible.
So, and I only can carry about 800, around 800 different SKUs of kosher wine. There's just so many options, and you know, there's different kinds. Definitely, I would say for sure in the whole Orthodox world, when it comes to wine, there's nothing sells more than Bartolomeo Moscato and Moscatos in general and the sweet wine.
That probably Jeunesse.
Right. Jeunesse. Yeah. Which by the way, Jeunesse is the number one mispronounced name on any kosher wine for sure.
That's a good trivia question.
Yeah, exactly.
Genesee, kosher wine trivia. What is the most mispronounced
name? It's that one. You said Jeunesse. It right. See?
I took French in high school.
Well, there you go. But I would say the good thing is that more and more people are coming in and they're moving from Moscato to Jeunesse. And then they're moving from Jeunesse to dry wine. And it is happening. And more, Jeunesse is a great, for someone who only knows.
Gateway. It's a gateway wine.
It is a gateway wine. Mm-hmm. And all the semi-sweets are really a good. And then the trick is to find, because what most people don't like on dry wine is they don't like the tannin. They don't like, right? So you know, the, when they go, right, when they pucker up, right? They don't
the astringency.
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm. So the thing with that when it comes to wine is that if it's a good wine and it has the right amount of air time or the right amount of time when it's coming to its own in the bottle, and again, this is more advanced, you know what I mean? When you get that, you're not going to get any of that astringency, and the tannins are going to come way down and they're going to integrate more with the fruit. So when someone but how many people in the world, or especially in the Orthodox Jewish world, are aging their wines 4 years, 5 years? Most people are coming in, buying a wine off the shelf and opening it. Mm. So, again, you have to sort of find what works for certain people. And certain people, there are a lot of customers that I know that I'll tell them, oh, well, you know, that needs to be aged, or it needs 2 hours in a decanter. Mm-hmm. Now, I have a lot of customers, again, but there are definitely a lot of customers that are not, you know, so into it. But when it comes to whiskey, on the other hand, is something that because of kiddishes and kiddish clubs, and we can talk about when we get into the COVID conversation, we can talk about what kiddishes and kiddish clubs have turned into, which is also interesting. Yeah. Is that because of that, whiskey has become very popular. Now, again, with or the Orthodox Jewish world, whiskey, I would say, you know, when I was a kid, you know, I walked into the, you know, I was 8 years old and I walked into the kitchen during the Haftarah, and there was four old men drinking a bottle of having a shot, one shot of a J&B, you know, the green bottle, right?
Is that a blended scotch?
What? Blended scotch. Yeah. We've come a long way. Mm-hmm. And single malt scotch is definitely the number one most popular. But the reason is true because it's the easiest to drink. It's like it's the most, if you take a bottle of single malt, a $40, $50, $60 bottle of single malt, and then you take a bourbon and you give it to someone who has whose palate doesn't have either, they'll find it easier to drink, most people, easier to drink the scotch than they will the bourbon.
We're talking like Speysides or Highlands.
Speysides.
We're not talking about any. Not talking about Lagavulin 16 or anything.
We're not talking about Lagavulin 16, but I sell a lot of Lagavulin 16.
It's a really delicious whiskey.
It's great. It's a fantastic scotch. Yeah. So again, the best thing that I love is that we have people on all levels. People that are entry level. People that people that don't know anything. Entry level, and the people that are getting into it. And we have and people at high level.
And you're probably like any liquor store in America, kosher or not, which is, like you said, the variety, but probably a fair amount of education also.
Correct. So one of the things that we really strive in our store is service. And when people come in, every single person that comes in the door, whether it's me or someone else there, we try to say, hi, let us know if you need any help. Like, we want right away. We don't, you know what I mean? To let you know that if you have any questions, please let us know. We're there not only, you know, to check you out and so you can walk away with your bottle, but we want to be able to help you find what you're looking for. And I think that's very important. And look, bourbons have exploded. And
really?
Which is fantastic.
You were just saying Scotch is doing well.
Scotch was for years. For years it was Scotch.
Oh, but this is recent.
If you're looking at, what's funny is that in the Orthodox Jewish world, we're always about 5 to 10 years behind on all trends, all trends, whatever they may be. Uh-huh. When it comes in the liquor world, so bourbons got hot in the big world probably about 5 to 10 years ago, right? I don't remember exactly, 8 to 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. And so in the last 4 or 5 years is really when bourbon started taking off in the Orthodox Jewish world. And now, what took off about 4 or 5 years ago in the big world was tequila. And now tequila, especially in the modern Orthodox world,
really?
Is becoming big.
You beat me to the punch because I have a local tequila friend, and he would have killed me if I didn't ask about tequilas and mezcals.
Yeah, tequilas are really, really growing. Wow. In a minute when we get to the COVID conversation, there's a whole thing with tequila and the supply chain, which we can talk about also.
That's a COVID thing. Although I was going to ask, so this has all been general. I do want to tequila. I'm going to ask about Passover, but sure. What about, so we talk about wine, whiskeys, tequila. What about beers?
Beer. Okay. So the thing with beer is that, and I love beer. And what's funny is that when I walked into this store, so I was into all, I have been into all liquor for a long time.
But beer,
right? But beer is where my passion originally came from. Came with right.
Yes.
And then I got into good wine and whiskey and all those and all these other things.
Yeah.
And what's crazy is that because of the way the store is and because beer is not such a focus, and it's not a it has not been a focus in this store. And I don't have a lot of space in this store. I have a four-door fridge, and that's where I keep. It was my first day.
And
that's the only place I can keep beer. That's the other thing. I'm not allowed to keep beer on the like. That was my first day with the conversation. But again, because I don't have room, because I need room for wine and scotch. And it also has to do with
because that sells better than beer.
Yeah, it has to right. Also do well. It sells better and also profit. You don't make. Beer, you make the least amount of profit of all the other. So at the end of the day,
it gets the least shelf space.
Correct. At the end of the day, unless you're doing volume, again with beer, like you go into a place like Total Wine, or one of the big box stores, they're doing crazy volume, and that's the same thing with the beer. Is that I can't compete price wise with the big box stores because the deals are usually, there's like a 3-case deal or a 5-case deal, which I can do, but most beers have a 10 or even a 20-case deal. And I can't do that because A, the space, and B, I can't move through it fast enough before it expires. And the expiration date, now they have almost every beer, there's an expiration date. And I can't, even though, as you know, some beer is good.
Just get all stouts and barley wines. You'll be fine.
Right. Exactly.
But I suspect those don't sell well.
So not so well, but I have a few because I love stouts and barley wines. So
that stuff will survive a few years sitting.
Right. But the ones of those I have are usually Boulevard or New Belgium because they have a Shkafa. They have kosher supervision, which is, you know what I mean? It again, they're good beer and they're good brew. You know what I mean? You've had those beers, right?
Yeah, they're good. Yeah.
Right. So because they have that, it also helps. The other thing is because most people, when they walk into the store, assume that everything in the store is kosher.
Mm-hmm.
And what I tell people when people ask me, I say, everything in the store is kosher according to somebody.
Okay.
Because not everything in the store is accepted according to the CRC or the OU, especially when they're doing events, because they have all these rules and regulations. Like, for example, they cut off at least 80% of the scotch that I sell. You can't bring to any of these events because they're in sherry. Casks or wine casks or whatever it may be. Now, I sell it. I have no problems, you know what I mean? And I have most of my customers will buy it. And what's crazy is that almost all of the rabbanim on the rabbis on the RCBC, which is the Rabbinical Council of Bergen County, if you would ask them personally, or if you're doing a kiddush in the shul with no caterer, they allow sherry cask scotch.
Good.
Most of the shuls in Bergen County. But if you're doing an event that they're doing the hashkacha on, or a restaurant that has the hashkacha, you cannot serve those because they follow the CRC liquor list.
Which follows Rabbi Niehaus's book.
Correct. Yes.
Interesting. Okay.
Hey, I hope you've been enjoying this episode so far. I just wanted to break in and see if you had any ideas, suggestions, whether that's for the show, whether that's for other Jewish drinking projects, if, who knows, maybe you have some ideas for speakers, for topics, or for just even just other things that I can bring to you as far as the Jewish Drinking Project, feel free to let me know at drew@jewishdrinking.com. All right, thank you, and now back into the show.
What about and this is pre-pandemic, although maybe some of this stuff extends into pandemic and beyond, of
sure.
Sort of the cycle of the year. I imagine obviously Purim and pre-Purim and pre-Passover are going to be busy seasons. Is that a fair assumption?
Yeah. So, yes. So
and then, there and then are, maybe also in the fall when we get to Rosh Hashanah and Sukkot, are those also
three busy seasons that we have? Yeah. Three. So the biggest is Purim Pesach. Mm-hmm. For me and the at Filler Up, that starts about 2 weeks before Purim. Mm-hmm. And that goes, it's one season. And which will, wow. as soon as we get into COVID, I'll tell you about it because it really was one. Yeah. And before pre-COVID, there was always a little break in between, but but that's not the case really anymore. But we'll see as we go forward as time, you know, whether it changes. And then there's the second busiest season is Rosh Hashanah Sukkot, which starts, which really only starts about a week before Rosh Hashanah, but actually it really only starts about 2 or 3 days before Rosh Hashanah.
So how much is it before Rosh Hashanah? How much is it leading up to Sukkot?
So again, between Yom Kippur and Sukkot, those 4 days are crazy.
Okay.
But the Aseret Yemei Tshuva, the between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur is usually slow. It's usually like, you know what I mean? Who's buying a liquor before leading up to Yom Kippur? It's like the one, you know.
Right.
But post Yom Kippur, it goes until even after. And then Chol HaMoed is also because...
That's just a lead up to the
Simchas Torah. Which is again, which is like, whereas Chol HaMoed Pesach time is always very low because people, they buy a lot going into Pesach. So people are only filling in on Chol HaMoed Pesach, whereas Chol HaMoed Sukkot, people are buying all new. Mm. It's like a different, you know, that's our second busiest season. And third busiest season is actually December is Hanukkah and the non-Jewish holidays. And that's a very busy season for us because of gifts. Everybody's buying gifts, whether they're buying gifts for Hanukkah or they're buying gifts for their coworkers. Clients, all sorts. And so that's a very busy season also. And then the other times of year are a little down, but again, you get a, you know, Shavuot, you get a little boost and then Shabbos. That's the thing. We have Shabbos. So getting back to Shabbos is like, you know, with wine and whiskey and beer, but like people have really been enjoying their Shabbos with libations lately, which is great.
So that's really Wednesday through Friday, basically.
Right.
Especially wine and whiskey, and sounds like a sprinkling of beer here and there and some tequila as well.
Right. And then Sunday, so when I was going through the week before, Sunday is a day which is interesting, is that we get a lot of people coming in from the city, right, from New York City, or the New York area, that are coming in to do shopping in Jersey or whatever. In Bergen County is blue laws, so you can't really do, there's a lot of shop you cannot do in Bergen County, but they're coming into Jersey on Sunday. So we get people that aren't our regular customers.
Are you allowed selling maybe after noon?
Noon. Yeah. Okay. You have to go to church first before you buy liquor in Bergen County.
Yeah.
Which again, people are annoyed by, but that's not my choice. That's the law. And then there's Simchas. And Simchas is something which has also been a very big, you know, a very big part of our business. Mm-hmm. And in COVID has been, you know, not so big as you know, there hasn't been, you know, people have not been able to celebrate Simchas in the same way.
Wow. There was so much to talk about in this episode with Mendy Mark, that, you guessed it, it became a second episode. This episode ended up just becoming a pre-pandemic purchasing episode. Stay tuned in a few weeks when we get to the pandemic sales part of this episode, or really it'll just become a part two, a sequel, if you will. So stay tuned in a few weeks for that, and back to the episode.
Mendy, thank you so much for joining this discussion and sharing your firsthand knowledge of this market, Mendy.
Awesome.
All right. Thank you. All right. And L'chaim.
L'chaim.